freedom is the core of humanity. Without freedom, there is no essence of humanity. So when there is no humanity, there is no question of other human rights. So in that sense, I salute Freedom House for working for the freedom of human being.
Throughout its 70-year history, Freedom House has remained steadfast to its commitment of advancing civil and political liberties around the world. The United States Civil Rights Movement represented a pivotal era where Freedom House's efforts reflected the transformational vision, sacrifice, and courage of great leaders and the people seeking basic rights and equality afforded to all Americans today. With the end of the Cold War, the Freedom House mission evolved to meet the new challenge of expanding freedom to societies under dictatorship and helping to stabilize free institutions in fragile new democracies. Freedom House has taken the lead in combining research, analysis, advocacy, and on-the-ground involvement in crisis areas in Central and Eastern Europe, the Balkans, and the former Soviet Union. It was among the earliest supporters of Poland's Solidarity Union and the growing strife in Africa and Central America. Freedom House has also become more active on the issue of religious freedom. In the post-September 11th era, Freedom House expanded its on-the-ground presence to more difficult environments, such as in Central Asia and the Middle East. Across the globe, the struggle for freedom continues. Growing militarism, the expanding threat of nuclear war, and brutal dictatorships affect the lives of millions. Freedom House's programs work to support human rights and democracy advocates in their efforts to promote open government, strengthen civil society, and facilitate the free flow of information and ideas in over 184 countries and 14 territories. Freedom House's flagship publication, Freedom in the World, is an annual report of global citizens' access to political and civil liberties. Each edition of Freedom in the World and other resources produced by Freedom House serve as a valuable tool for leaders, activists, and others to measure the condition of global freedom, as well as identify future challenges. This year, upon our 70th anniversary, our work is just beginning.
Happy birthday, Freedom House.
We are from Cameroon. Happy birthday, Freedom House.
70 years of Freedom House. May you live to be 700.
I think that your voice is very important.
So I pray that Freedom House would continue to thrive. It's obviously a well-established institution.
And I want to wish the best for this organization and that you keep doing the good work.
Hopefully, Freedom House can continue his struggles for religious freedom in the rest of the world.
Good evening, and welcome to the Freedom House 70th Anniversary Gala. I am Mara Liasson. I'm a former Freedom House board member, and I am really thrilled to be able to be here this evening to celebrate this landmark event and serve as your MC. When Eleanor Roosevelt and Wendell Willkie served as honorary co-chairs of Freedom House in 1941, they and the founders dreamed of an organization that would stand as a symbol and center for the fight for freedom, and to act as a beacon lighting the struggle for a free world. 70 years later, Freedom House has honored that commitment, which brings us here tonight to recognize the accomplishments of Freedom House and celebrate those who have committed themselves to the pursuit of freedom and human rights. I would like to begin by introducing our two gala co-chairs, Ambassador Paula Dobriansky and the Honorable Thomas Dine.
Thank you, Mara, for emceeing tonight and continuing your feelings of responsibility toward Freedom House. We very much appreciate your past service. And before handing the microphone over to Paula, I would like to propose a toast to the 70th birthday of Freedom House. Hear, hear.
Well, good evening, everyone. As co-chairs of the Freedom House 70th Anniversary Gala, Tom and I want to thank all of the people who made tonight possible through their hard work, many contributions, and dedicated service. Tom.
The Board of Trustees 70th Anniversary Dinner Committee reached out to many, many friends, colleagues, and supporters who have joined us here tonight. So we would first like to thank our chairman of the board, the Honorable William H. Taft IV. Other members of our committee, Rebecca Halley, Jeffrey Hirschberg, Catherine Dickey Carroll, Faith Morningstar, Joshua Moravchek, Diana Negroponte, Lisa Nelson.
Thanks to all of you. We'd also like to thank all the other members of the Board of Trustees whose collective experience has provided insights and advice that helps guide Freedom House throughout the year and whose extensive outreach and support of the 70th anniversary has really made this event tonight a huge success. And I'd like to ask each of them to stand, but not until I announce each of your names. And let me just also add, not only do we thank all of our Board of Trustees, but two people I want to just thank and for the generosity, Mark Palmer and also Kim Davis. We thank you for your generous support for this evening. And let me ask each and every one of them to stand, our Board of Trustees. Will Taft, Tom Dine, he is standing, as you see, Ruth Wedgwood, John Norton Moore, Walter Schloss, Ken Edelman, Golia Mary, Stuart Applebaum, Susan Bennett, James Carter, Antonio Cortese, Lee Cullum, Charles Davidson, Kim Davis, Alan Dye, Rebecca Haley, Jeff Hirschberg, Ken Juster, Max Campbellman, Catherine Dickey Carroll, Betty Bow Lord, Jay Mazur, Theodore Mervis, Alberto Mora, Faith Morningstar, Josh Morovchik, David Nastro, Andrew Nathan, Diana Negroponte, Lisa Nelson, Mark Palmer, Scott Siff, Rich Williamson, Wendell Wilkie, Jennifer Windsor, and Richard Winfield. Thank you so much. We would also like to specially thank board member Susan Bennett, who made it possible for us, in fact, to hold this event this evening at this extraordinary venue here tonight at the museum.
Thank you, Susan. Finally, a heartfelt thank you to our generous donors, without whom Freedom House would not be able to carry on the extraordinary work of advancing freedom throughout the world for another 70 years and beyond. We are all grateful, and we are determined to keep it up. So we're happy to recognize them in your program journal, as well as on the video screens around the room.
This is truly a special night in many ways. And as we pay tribute to Freedom House's past, while looking forward to our goals for tomorrow, we are honored that several descendants of Herbert Agar are here with us tonight. As many of you know, Mr. Agar was one of the original founders of Freedom House in 1941, and in fact, its first president. There are also several former Freedom House staff and board members who we are delighted could be here with us this evening. We especially want to mention Mr. Ned Bandler, who served for some 45 years, I understand, on Freedom House's board, and many of those as its vice chair. And Mr. Leonard Sussman, Freedom House's executive director, for more than 20 some years. They are both part of the reason that we are in fact are here tonight. Could you both stand? And we'd like to give you a round of applause. Thank you.
When Paula read that you had served for 45 years as the vice chair, and I said to myself, that's how much more time I have?
They didn't tell you?
We'd also like to thank the honorary co-chairs of our event, former secretaries Condoleezza Rice and Madeleine Albright. Unfortunately, scheduling conflicts prevented their attendance with us this evening, but I'm happy to introduce taped remarks from Dr. Rice. So let's roll it.
Good evening, and welcome to Freedom House's 70th anniversary gala dinner. I, like my co-chair, Madeleine Albright, am very sorry that we cannot be there with you tonight. I have many friends in the audience, and I want to join you in toasting this extraordinary achievement of 70 years defending freedom. Since its inception in 1941, Freedom House has advocated for the proposition that every man, woman, and child deserves to live in freedom. It is a moral cause. It is a moral cause that has gained traction across the world through the good works of places like Freedom House and strong, strong advocates like those being honored tonight. And so I join you in honoring and congratulating Aung San Suu Kyi, Ambassador Max Kampelman, my good friend, the editorial board of the Washington Post, and Google. The search for freedom comes at a cost. Many lives have been lost over that 70 years in assuring that the universal right to say what you think, to worship as you please, to educate your boys and your girls, to be free from the knock of the secret police at night, is achieved in common for all people. But Freedom House tonight, as it celebrates 70 years in the trenches doing that hard work, can also bask in the many achievements that we have seen over these last years. I myself was a young Soviet specialist who went there first in 1979 to a place where basic freedoms were denied, where the thought that people might elect their leaders was certainly not on anyone's radar screen, and where the Soviet Union held sway over half of Europe. And even though today there continue to be struggles in Russia and abroad, Eastern Europe is a very different place. Who would have thought that in 2006 an American president would actually go to a NATO summit in Latvia? But obviously there is much more work to do. As the Arab Spring unfolds, we see the fragility of human freedom and the difficulty of translating freedom and liberty into democracy. And yet we know that because of the hard work of impatient patriots like those that we honor tonight, and the hard work of Freedom House, which has advocated for those rights, that several years from now, maybe at the 80th anniversary, we will be here to celebrate an even further March of Freedom. Thank you very much for being there tonight to celebrate this extraordinary set of achievements. I want to say to the board of Freedom House, to all of its supporters, to my friends, and especially to the honorees, the work of democracy and freedom is never done. It is a journey, not a destination. Thank you for the hard work along that road.
Thank you for such great words. This evening, I have the distinct honor of introducing the president of Freedom House. Laura.
Mara.
You got to be up here, girl.
You got to get out of the way.
She has the distinct honor.
Okay, like he was saying, I have the distinct honor of introducing the president of Freedom House, David Kramer. Many of you may know David from his time at the State Department or perhaps recognize his name from the byline of the Washington Post or the Wall Street Journal op-ed pages. Some of you might know him as Washington, D.C.'s biggest Boston Red Sox fan. I think even those diehard Yankee fans can agree we are lucky to have David at the helm. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome David Kramer.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much, Mara. Thank you very much. Welcome back to Freedom House. We're delighted to welcome you back. I also want to acknowledge all the ambassadors, all the members of Congress, representatives from the administration, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for joining us here this evening. What I would like to do is to let you eat. So if you don't mind, I'm going to come back right after we finish eating. We'll pick up with the program and continue on from there. So if we can, we'll cue to dinner. Thank you.
Okay, we're gonna start the program again. Why don't you do a little more of that? Ladies and gentlemen, Congresswoman Anna Eshoo serves California's 14th District in the United States House of Representatives. As a member of the Energy and Commerce Committee, she is currently the ranking member of the Subcommittee on Communications and Technology. This distinction alone uniquely qualifies her to introduce our first award, although the recipient also happens to be headquartered in her home district. Just a coincidence. Ladies and gentlemen, presenting the Corporate Leadership Award, Congresswoman Anna Eshoo.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Thank you, Mara, very much. I just said to Mara, I like very brief introductions. It's wonderful to be here with you this evening, and I want to thank Freedom House for inviting me to be part of the program this evening. And I want to begin by congratulating Freedom House on its 70 years, almost three quarters of a century, promoting human rights around the world. It's a remarkable achievement, and your work is a tribute to the legacies of your first chairwoman and first chairman, Eleanor Roosevelt and Wendell Willkie. Yeah. It's an honor to present Freedom House's first ever Corporate Leadership Award to a company that I've known since it was born 13 years ago in my congressional district in California. California's 14th, which is the home to Stanford University and to Silicon Valley. Yeah, let's hear it. They're doing well on the field, too. In 1996, as grad students at Stanford University, Larry Page and Sergey Brin began collaborating on an internet search engine called Backrub. I bet most of you don't remember that. Google, as it was later renamed, would officially get its start in 1998 in a Menlo Park garage. Since that time, I've watched with great, great pride as Google has grown into a company of more than 30,000 employees. Imagine, 30,000 employees, and with at least one-third of them in my congressional district. Today, Google is not only one of the most powerful search engines in the world, it's an engine for change. As people around the world struggle for their basic freedoms of expression, their freedom of press, and their freedom of religion, Google connects them and empowers them in ways that we never would have dreamed of or ever thought possible before. Despite its rapid growth, Google has maintained its reputation as a respected corporate citizen, both here in the United States and around the world. Google has challenged internet restrictions brought on by oppressive regimes and joined as a founding member, and I'm really proud of this, of the Global Network Initiative, which endorses a code of conduct focusing on protecting free speech online and combating government censorship on the internet. The Freedom House Corporate Leadership Award acknowledges these successes and recognizes the wide range of free tools, and I want to repeat that word, free. Free tools and services developed by Google, which have helped promote democracy and human rights around the world. So please join me in watching the way Google has impacted the world. You are now going to see a wonderful video that underscores that.
What began as a research project by two Stanford PhD students in 1996 has grown into a multinational company globally employing over 28,000 employees. Google's name is synonymous with information access and connectivity. Google has not only redefined how people use the internet, it has further broadened its innovations into other communication mediums, impacting the world as we understand and view it. Google's management team, led by Sergey Brin, Eric Schmidt, and Larry Page, lead their industry through corporate responsibility and have advanced ideals of transparency. Google developed the Transparency Report, which details government requests to remove content or to hand over data on an easy-to-read map. The Transparency Report shows traffic to Google originating from countries throughout the world. For example, the report shows the Libyan censorship of both YouTube and Google in February of 2011. Providing access to this information makes Google an industry leader in reporting about freedom. Similarly to Freedom House, Google has long advocated global access to information and free expansion and is available in over 130 languages in more than 115 countries. Other Google products, such as YouTube, have further transformed the way people share their stories, emotions, and information. Despite barriers to free expression, people continue to use Google's technology as a vehicle to rise up and demand their rights and freedom. Technology is ultimately a reflection of our needs and desires. Google continues to demonstrate that people will use innovative tools and innovative ways to organize and express themselves.
I failed to mention something when I first came to the microphone, and that is that I saw my colleague who served in the House with such great distinction and integrity, the former congressman from Arizona, Jim Colby. Where is Jim? Jim, I'm sure he's still here. A man of great, great integrity, and we miss him. So I want to congratulate Google on this very well-deserved award, and I look forward to their continued success. I'm so proud of this American company and what it has imported or exported around the world. Tonight is another jewel in the crown of Google, and I think it's a very important one. I want to welcome to the stage really an exceptional man, Bob Bornstein, who is the Director of Public Policy at Google, and I know that you're going to welcome him the way you welcomed me. Thank you, everyone. It's a real pleasure to be with you. Yeah. Congratulations, Bob. Thank you. Really wonderful.
Now that I've been welcomed, we're going to see a video from the person you'd rather see, who is Sergey Brin. So why don't we roll that video first, please?
It's a great honor for me to accept this recognition today. And I'm very excited about the role that the internet has played and can continue to play in empowering political expression. I think this is a really fundamental, very important force for good. And I think that technology has been very helpful. At the same time, we've seen some people try to use technology to suppress expression. And I think that there is a lot of risk in the world today. Nevertheless, I feel confident that if we continue to really protect freedom of political expression via the internet, via mobile phones, via technology, I think that we're going to have a very bright future to look forward to.
So I bring apologies from Sergey, and I know that he would be here if he could. He's actually a new father, second time around, and he wisely decided what his priorities should be. I also do want to clear up a couple of things. The first is that Sergey does own a tie. He doesn't wear it, but he does own it. When he came to Washington once, he did wear a tie when he visited the Senate, but he also wore those funny shoes that had the toes in them. You know those things? Anyway. I want to say thank you to Secretaries Rice and Albright and the board of Freedom House, the chairs of the dinner tonight, and to Bill Taft, who's done such amazing service for this country and now for this organization. Thank you very much. I also wanted to say thank you to David Kramer, to Daniel Kallengard, wherever Daniel is here, and to the entire staff of Freedom House. Actually, they're the people who do all the work, so I think we owe them a round of applause. As you might imagine, we at Google get the occasional request for funds from groups that claim to be doing good work around the world. With Freedom House, we found people who not only hold fast to their principles, but who actually produce. And we are really proud of our relationship with Freedom House, and we are proud to support the work they do, and especially the work they've done to monitor the state of free expression on the internet, unique work that they do that nobody else in the world does as well. 70 years is a long time to be in the business of trying to promote and protect freedom around the world, and Freedom House has many accomplishments it can be proud of. But as we all know, and as Secretary Rice told us, there is so much left to do, so much uncertainty, so many threats. I want all of you who have gathered here tonight to celebrate freedom, to know that Google will continue to give voice to those who were previously muted or silenced, and to provide a platform for the marketplace of ideas, a marketplace that ought to be open to everyone, regardless of where they live or the circumstances into which they were born. Access to those ideas, like freedom itself, is a universal human right. And on behalf of Google's 30,000 employees around the world, we pledge to continue our work, and we thank you very much for this honor.
Well, as I was saying, after 18 and a half years living in Washington, I've learned that when you're standing between an audience and food, or between a member of Congress who's on a very tight schedule, the best place to be is out of the way. So I'm more than happy to yield on both occasions. Ladies and gentlemen, 2011, the year marking Freedom House's 70th anniversary, has certainly been a fascinating one, given the developments in the Middle East and North Africa. The revolutions in Tunisia, Egypt, and Libya have demonstrated that the desire to live in freedom is universal, not limited to a specific culture or region. As long as Ben Ali, Mubarak, and Gaddafi remained in power, Tunisia, Egypt, and Libya had no hope or possibility of moving in a democratic direction. Their removal from power by no means guarantees that these countries will join the free category in our Freedom of the World rankings anytime soon. There is no linear path toward becoming a democracy. But Tunisians, Egyptians, and Libyans themselves, for the first time in decades, have the hope and possibility of shaping their country's futures along a more democratic path. And while the future of these countries will be determined by the people who live in them, organizations like Freedom House have a clear role to play in supporting civil society and human rights defenders and standing unwaveringly in support of those seeking greater freedom and respect for human rights. Our job is to ensure that those deprived of their voice temporarily are not left speechless permanently. That's true beyond the Middle East as well, including in countries deemed the worst of the worst, like China, North Korea, Uzbekistan, Belarus, Cuba, and Burma. That was one of the reasons why we felt it was so important to recognize Burma's Aung San Suu Kyi this evening. The challenges those of us in the democratic world face are steep. Indeed, worldwide, according to our Freedom of the World rankings, nearly 2.5 billion people, a little over a third of the world's population, live in countries that we deem not free. This means that the work we and our fellow democracy and human rights organizations, and many of them are here this evening, and I'm grateful they came, the work we do remains as vital as ever. And it's heartening to know that in our corner are other recipients of awards this evening, Fred Hyatt and Jackson Deal from the Washington Post, Google, and our chairman emeritus, Max Kampelman. Award dinners such as this one require lots of hard work and planning. In fact, we haven't done one of these in 15 years. For starters, we wouldn't be in this fabulous location if it were not for Susan Bennett, Jim Duff, and the museum, and our deep appreciation to them. My thanks as well to my friends Paula Dobriansky and Tom Dine, and the entire 70th committee of the board for being so supportive, and also a special thanks to my chairman, Will Taft, for being such a gracious and generous gentleman and chairman. Epiphany Productions has been a terrific partner of Freedom House over the past few months, and Julie Wadler, we are grateful to you and your team for all your effort and hard work. Many of my colleagues on the Freedom House staff were key to making tonight possible, in particular Mary McGuire, Sarah Trister, Nina Patel, Kellen McClure, Charmise Hardy, and J.J. Emru. One other person deserves special mention, and that is Mary Mears. Quite simply, Mary, without your leadership and hard work, none of us would be here this evening, so thank you very much. I do want to recognize two more people. Walter Schloss, Freedom House's longest serving current board member, and our treasurer was not able to be with us this evening. Walter's commitment to and support for the organization and the cause of freedom over the years are simply unparalleled. At 95 years of age, however, Walter's decided it's time to do some other things. And so he's stepping down from the board. But Walter, if you're watching, many, many thanks to you for all your friends and admirers at Freedom House. And finally, the other person I'd like to acknowledge is my predecessor, Jennifer Windsor. When I joined Freedom House just over a year ago, I inherited one of the finest democracy and human rights organizations around. That is due first and foremost to the outstanding and dedicated staff that I have the privilege of working with every day. It's also due to the leadership that preceded me with Jennifer and Tom Melia, who's also with us this evening, both of whom left pretty big shoes to fill, even for a guy with 12 shoes. So in recognition of her years of service to Freedom House and her enduring passion for the cause of freedom and human rights, I've asked Jennifer to introduce tonight's main speaker. Please join me in extending a warm welcome to Jennifer Windsor.
Thank you, David. I just want to say that Freedom House is indeed fortunate to have attracted such a talented, highly regarded, and I might add, very diplomatic individual like you to be president. It's quite an improvement over the previous incumbent of this position. So I'm so privileged to be asked to introduce my good friend, Azar Nafisi. Azar is not just a best-selling author, although she is that. She is not just an advocate for human rights, although she is that as well. Azar is a freedom activist. And as any freedom activist or advocate, Azar has made enemies. She has made those enemies by telling the truth, and telling that truth eloquently and relentlessly. She's endured vicious personal attacks and smear campaigns that have been orchestrated by those inside and outside of Iran who've sought to demean her in order to undercut her message that freedom and human rights matter. But those enemies have seriously underestimated who Azar Nafisi is. This is one strong lady, not easily deterred, even by dictators. 70 years ago, Freedom House was founded to be a center for those who were willing to speak out for freedom, even when it was unpopular to do so. We were honored to have Azar Nafisi serve for years on Freedom House's Board of Trustees, and we are thrilled that she could be here tonight to help us celebrate Freedom House's past achievements and to galvanize us all to meet the current and future challenges to freedom around the world. Azar Nafisi.
It is such an honor, privilege, and pleasure to be here today to celebrate Freedom House's 70 years. As I was sitting here listening to everyone, I kept thinking, what is it about a place like this that makes me feel so much at home? Because, you know, home is not just a geographical location. Home is a place where you can share the same passions, the same vision, the same dreams with people you have never met, and all of a sudden, from strangers, they become intimate strangers because of the fact that you share the same vision. And then I remembered that, I went back to Iran two days after I finished my dissertation, which was in 1979, and I left it in 1997, and I always tell people, don't go where I go, because wherever I go, something happens. But the point is that when I was leaving in 1997, one of the things that my mother for almost a week kept telling me, she kept telling me, tell him. And what she said echoed in almost everyone else that I met. My uncle who had lost a son and a daughter-in-law to this regime. A student who had been jailed for 10 years for passing out flyers and who had been executed. They all wanted people like me to tell them. Because all of you in this room know that when you live under a tyrannical regime, and the first thing that totalitarian mindset does, no matter where they are, is to confiscate your right as a unique individual. And when you live like that, the most important thing for you is not to feel alone, and to know that there are people around the world who sort of retrieve your confiscated reality, who give voice to the silences that have been imposed by you. In fact, to give you reality, to become witnesses to the fact that indeed there is conclusive evidence that you have lived by carrying your voice, by empathizing with you. And so, you know, it is not very strange that when I came to this country, when I returned back to this country, that was interesting. Freedom House became one home that I don't think I will ever want to leave. It's a sort of a natural place to come back to. And you know, you talked about truth, and we've talked about silences and giving voices, and I think that this is what makes Freedom House always dangerous to all the totalitarian mindsets, no matter where in the world. The search for truth, because truth in and of itself is always dangerous. Once you know the truth, you're implicated, and you can no more remain silent. And that is something that dictators know much better than some of the people who live in democracies. And that is what they sort of become rivals in with those who are in the field of human rights and freedom of expression. I just wanted to say one point. I know that it is lovely to talk about democracy until you have the podium, and then you think that you can go on forever. But one thing that David, you mentioned, and everyone else I think in this room agrees with me, and one thing that I was absolutely shocked when I came to this country, there was that a lot of people, when I talked about the rights of women, the rights of minorities, the rights of the journalists, the rights of people to freedom of expression, a lot of people at that time, they don't say it anymore, at that time they would look at me and they say, oh, but you're Western. And it's their culture, as if it is the Afghani or Iranian or Saudi Arabian women's culture to want to be flogged for the way they dress. I mean, if people wanted to be flogged, then that could not be their culture, could it? Because if people want something, if it is their culture, if it is their tradition, no one has to put a gun to their head. No one has to pass a law to force them to do something. As if girls at the age of 9 liked to be married by their fathers, as if women enjoyed polygamy. As if traditional Muslim women from poorest families liked to be stoned to death because that was their culture. And so I had to remind my friends that every culture has something to be ashamed of, that if that is my culture, then Inquisition and fascism and communism is the culture of Europe, and not Dante and Goethe and Flaubert and Auden and Emily Bronte and Jane Austen and St. Thomas Aquinas and St. Augustine. If that is my culture, then slavery is the culture of this country, and not Abraham Lincoln and Frederick Douglass and Sojourner Truth and Zora Neale Hurston. Because every culture has something to be ashamed of. And every culture, no matter where we are, has the right to ask for the right to be free, to life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. I don't know of any woman in the world who doesn't want to pursue happiness, who says that, oh, pursuing happiness is really an American thing. I just enjoy being stoned. And so I want to, take 3 or 4 minutes to say that what we call the Arab Spring, and you have to remember that before the Arab Spring, it was the 2009 uprising in Iran, when the Iranian people, for the first time, these amazing faces, Muslim and non-Muslim, young and old, traditional and secular, men and women, they all blossomed and burst on the faces of the internet and television. And as I was watching that, and as I was watching people getting killed, I kept thinking, the way I did with Egypt and with Tunisia and with Libya, that how heartbreaking that apart from places like this, people would not understand that these people have existed until they died, until they were killed. But also, I know about a place like Freedom House because human rights knows no boundaries of nationality, ethnicity, language, religion, gender, or race. And because of that, I know that whether the dictator who until about a month ago was murdering thousands of his own people, and the ones who replace him have to remember that they cannot become like him, that they cannot have that violence which they were against until yesterday be now imposed upon the society and upon the world. And again, I think Freedom House will not remain silent. And for that also, it would not be liked. So I just wanted to end by sort of a quotation from the Bard, as they say, in Merchant of Venice, where he talks about, if you prick us, we all bleed. Because no matter where you live, in Afghanistan, in Libya, in Saudi Arabia, in Darfur, in New Orleans, We all bleed. And that is our common humanity. And that is what we call empathy. Not just the differences. It is very dangerous to talk about the differences without talking about our common humanity. And it is very dangerous to talk about difference without remembering that fundamentalism and terror, as well as democracy and human rights, know no boundaries. They know no east or west. Eleanor Roosevelt and Wendell Weeklin knew that, and they understood it very well. For Eleanor Roosevelt, the most important thing in her life, achievement in her life, was the creation of the Declaration of Human Rights. And I want to just mention something. Some people think that human rights is not pragmatic. You know, they look at it in a utilitarian way. I want to tell you that human rights and support is not philanthropic. It is pragmatic. It is to your advantage to have democratic allies around the world, because they would not come and bomb you in airplanes. It is to your advantage also because the way you look at the world and view the world and treat the world is a reflection of the way you look at yourself and treat yourself. And as a new immigrant who's rather naive, and rather excited, I wanted to tell you, this is why people like me come to this country. Not to fill our pockets necessarily, although we do like to have a decent life. Not success at any cost, but because of that vision that created something out of nothing, that helped in this country 70 years ago create such an institution. And I want to remind you that there is not much difference between an Islamic republic that not only targets its women and minorities, but targets culture in the same manner that the worst totalitarian states in the world did. You remember that in the Islamic Republic of Iran, they took Desdemona out of most scenes of Sarah Lawrence Olivier's Othello, and they took Othello's suicide out because they said that the masses will be depressed. The masses apparently won't be depressed to be stoned to death, they say, well, we can't help it, but they don't like Sir Laurence Olivier to be stoned, committing suicide on screen. This is a reminder of Soviet Union that also called Camus and Sartre and Hemingway and Faulkner as decadent imperialists, the same culture that banned the death of swan out of Swan Lake so that the masses would not be depressed. The same culture that in the fantastic movie Ninochka, that immortal line by Ninochka when she talks about how she doesn't want her underwear to undermine the state. These are the subversive elements. So I want, I'm sorry, I keep saying I want to end and I don't end. So this time I'm really ending. But I want, as a new American, to remind you that I think in the best that America has to offer, and it has offered the best and the worst in many ways, I want to go back to its founders that could transcend their own times and their own prejudices. And I want to remind people, when they talk about utilitarianism and pragmatism, of the first president of this country who had said to be enlightened was to be the citizen of the great republic of humanity at large. They knew that to be an American also meant to be a citizen of the world. And this republic of humanity has a close link with the republic of imagination, with the right to imagine something that has not happened and make it happen, with vision, with innovation. And none of this will come without this constant struggle in pursuit of freedom. And so as Eleanor Roosevelt knew, your weapons in the West and in this great country are not military, they are cultural. That is what tyrants are afraid of, and that is what they had been afraid of. So I want to celebrate Freedom House 70th birthday with words of one of its great recipients, Aung San Suu Kyi. She talks of a strong and upright tree, spreading out stout branches richly covered with leaves and laden with fruit, offering shelter and substance to all who come under its shade. And she says that 10,000 birds can perch on one good tree. I want us to salute those numerous birds around the world that have perched on the branches of this one good tree. And I want to happy birthday that very, very good tree for its 70th birthday. Thank you.
I feel we should all be quiet for about 15 minutes and think about that. Catch our breath. Our second presenter this evening has traveled quite a way to be with us. Lamis Daif is an award-winning journalist from Bahrain, achieving notoriety as presenter of a program on Al Rai, which is a private Kuwaiti television channel that dealt with taboo issues such as poverty, prostitution, corruption, and inequality. We are very thankful to her for making the trip to present the Raising Awareness Award. Our prayers are with Lamisa's family as the news about her sister's arrest and sentencing for providing medical assistance to the protesters in Bahrain is reported. Please welcome Lamis Daif.
Thank you, Mara. And yes, every day we pray for my sister's safety and for thousands of Bahraini youth and activists who were horribly targeted because they ask for democracy, freedom, and justice. Raising awareness regarding human rights is essential, especially in today's world, where people continue fighting over power and gains. In Kenya, they say that when elephants fight, it is the grass that is squashed. And I fear that people like me are the grass in today's world. That yes, it looked so civil, but it's only a big fancy jungle ruled by power and interests. I might sound a bit pessimistic because people in my own country are struggling since February. While lots of countries have supported other Arab revolutions, they ignored our battle because we are not opposing someone they already hate, like al-Qaddafi or al-Assad. Instead, we are facing the kingdoms of petrol that every country wants to be their ally. Yet, we find consolation in sincere and courageous people like the staff of the Washington Post editorial board, who succeeded in shedding some light on issues of human rights and democracy in literally every region of the world, including my own. I recall the day when I was so frustrated by the whole situation, when I received a broadcast from Bahraini, thrilled about an article regarding us published in such a respected newspaper. It was translated immediately and was widely distributed. I remember telling myself that day, if there is someone on the other side of the planet believing in us and what we stand for, then we have to fight to the end. No one should underestimate the power of the honest word. It's the perfect way to initiate change because ink is the voice of our blood and tears. All of those oppressed on the world. Without your ink, all effort of those brave citizens fighting for fundamental rights are wasted. I'm really honored to present this award to such a newspaper for all its effort in making this word a better place. The knowledge and awareness that you present to the world inspire defenseless people to continue their struggle. We have no oil, no machine guns or tanks, but we have dreams and beliefs, and we look up to people like you not to let us down. I flew 16 hours to stand here on behalf of dozens of mothers who wish to say thank you. Thanks to the Washington Post staff, one by one, for caring about people like us. You opened a window when the others tried to suffocate and enslave us by fabricating the truth about the Bahraini Revolution. Thank you for responding when the human rights group raised the alarm, and we wish that you would hold the U.S. and other governments accountable, especially when their policies go against fundamental freedoms to which we are all entitled. With editorial page editor Fred Hyatt, veteran reporter and published author, and deputy editor Jackson Dale as a finalist for 2011 Pulitzer Prize in editorial writing, clearly the writers at the Washington Post editorial board are the highest caliber.
The Washington Post specifically, and Jackson Deal, when we met with them in America, we felt they knew and followed what we wrote, and that they cared about us long before 2011. Since the political advocacy started in Egypt in 2004 and 2008, their writing about us was a great support to us and helped us in communicating our message to the outside world that we are trying to use the simplest ways at hand to communicate. Their use of Facebook Girl about me personally led to the people and youth in Egypt starting to use the social networking tool to promote democracy in Egypt.
Washington Post speaks with a voice that represents the free world. In the countries where dictators oppress the people, where freedoms and rights are restricted, and where people don't have an opportunity to speak up, it is the Washington Post that represents their voice.
Washington Post is one of the newspapers that I remember very early on, since 2003, tackling the issues of democracy and human rights in Egypt. And I remember one of the op-eds that was written in 2003 that specifically talked about the Egypt's unchecked record of human rights and how that democracy and aid, one of the major leverage point that the U.S. can use in the Egypt case, have never been used effectively. And that was, I think, one of the added value that they were able to bring, putting pressure on U.S. policymakers to use the power they have in support of democracy and human rights.
To be here tonight to present the Washington Post editorial board with the Freedom House 211 Raising Awareness Award. Salam alaikum.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Lamiz. If I start crying instead of giving my thank you, it's your fault. So David made me promise not to take more than 45 minutes for this, and I... No, is that wrong? 20 years ago, as the Soviet Union was crumbling, I was with my wife, the Post co-bureau chief in Moscow. Actually, to be totally honest, the anniversary of the Soviet Union crumbling is 2 months from now. And on that day, in a reflection of our unerring news judgment, we were on vacation in Paris. But never mind. The point I want to make is there was at that time euphoria about the inevitable progress of freedom. East Asia had rounded the corner, then Central Europe, and now the 15 Soviet republics would surely be next. Today we are perhaps a bit wiser. We were not wrong back then to believe that democracy, for all its evident imperfections and frustrations, is the best system. Nor were we wrong to believe, as the Arab Spring has reminded us all over again, that people everywhere, without exception, no matter their culture or history or religion, want to live in freedom. But there may have been some naivete in expecting the autocrats of the world to sit back and allow the forces of history to act upon them. Instead, we have seen the dictators mobilize and fight back, at times very adeptly. The internet, widely believed at first to be the final nail in autocracy's coffin, turns out to be a two-edged sword, a medium that can be blocked more successfully than was predicted and even used as an implement of repression. Some dictators have become far more skillful than in the past in deploying Washington lobbyists and think tanks on their side. My impression is that the forces of freedom have not yet fully adjusted or responded to this relentless counterattack. But Freedom House, and many of you in this room, both with and without Freedom House, are leading the way. In an era of increasingly slick and successful propaganda from the dictators, the work that Freedom House does in assembling meticulous, unassailable, dispassionate data and analysis on the real trends of freedom around the world is absolutely indispensable. I think we can't emphasize enough how much good journalism everywhere depends on what you do. In that regard, I'd like to say one thing about your relatively new president, if I could, although I'm sure most of you know him by now better than I do. Some people who talk about and write about freedom when they are in the think tank world or the academic world develop a more, as they might put it, pragmatic approach when they enter government. David was not one of those people. He's always understood that there's nothing naive about promoting freedom and nothing pragmatic or realistic about slighting it. His work at Freedom House is a straight line from how he has acted for as long as he has been in Washington. So I'm very grateful and honored, as all of us are at the Post, for this award. But if you permit, I'd like to thank two other groups of people. Jackson is the intellectual engine and the foundation of principle for all our foreign policy editorials, including the ones on Bahrain. That's another way of saying he does most of the work. But neither Jackson nor I could do any of this without the support of our bosses over the years, specifically my predecessor, the late Meg Greenfield, and our late chairman, Kay Graham, who together made human rights a priority of the page, and Donald Graham, our chairman today, Bo Jones, our former publisher, and Catherine Weymouth, our current publisher. All of them have not only allowed, but have encouraged us to speak for those who are muzzled, not because it helps their bottom line, but because it's the right thing to do. Finally, and most of all, I'd like to thank the many dissidents and freedom fighters who have written op-eds for us over the years, often at great risk to themselves. 4 years ago, for example, we published an op-ed by Ugambira, a monk who had helped lead the still unfinished Saffron Revolution in Burma. "We adhere to nonviolence, but our spine is made of steel," he wrote. "There is no turning back. It matters little if my life or the lives of colleagues should be sacrificed on this journey. Others will fill our sandals, and more will join and follow." By coincidence, on the day his op-ed appeared, Ugambira, who had been living in hiding inside his country, was found and arrested. Things in Burma, as we will no doubt hear shortly, may be stirring in the right direction. But Ugambira remains in prison, and just this week we saw reports that his health may be in jeopardy. So we'd like to dedicate this award to him and to the day when we can print his next op-ed in the Washington Post. Thank you very much.
Will Taft is chairman of the board of Freedom House. As Freedom House is a clear and steadfast voice for freedom, Will Taft is a clear and steadfast voice for Freedom House. And for that, we are very grateful. Will's leadership has truly made an impact on Freedom House. Please join me in welcoming the Honorable William H. Taft to present the Lifetime Achievement Award.
Thank you very much. I'm delighted to be here to present to my good friend and colleague, Ambassador Max Kampelman, the Freedom House 2011 Lifetime Achievement Award. Most people would actually need several lifetimes to achieve what Max has done in one. His drive for justice and human rights has taken him through decades of unparalleled just successes in the quest for peace and for freedom. Max went to law school in Minnesota. While he was there, a young politician named Hubert Humphrey became mayor of Minneapolis. This was an important development for the future Senator Humphrey, but also for Max, who became Hubert Humphrey's friend and supporter for life. When Max finished law school, he worked with Humphrey in the Senate and later during his several presidential campaigns. But this brilliant work in domestic politics and law was not enough for Max. He was launched into the larger global stage. His outstanding reputation led President Carter to ask Max to become the head of the American delegation and ambassador to the Conference on Security and Cooperation in Europe. Max led the conference and also shaped the companion U.S. Helsinki Commission to establish the founding principles of advancing comprehensive security through the promotion of human rights and democracy in over 50 countries. Those values remain the basis of the accords today. Max was called to service again after President Carter's summons by President Reagan to be the ambassador and head of the United States delegation in the negotiations with the Soviet Union on nuclear and space arms. The late 80s was a fragile time in U.S. foreign policy and a period that encompassed the transformation of the Soviet Union. Max was a masterful, highly respected, and dedicated negotiator in the strategic arms talks with the Soviets during that period. Max's life's work brought about a safer, more peaceful, and most importantly for us, a more free world. These and so many other accomplishments, including his time as, for many years, as chairman of Freedom House, were recognized by President Reagan when he awarded Max the Presidential Citizens Medal for people who have, and I quote President Reagan here, performed exemplary deeds or services for his or her country or fellow citizens. That's what President Reagan said about Max. President Clinton said that Max made an especially meritorious contribution to the security and national interests of the United States and world peace. And in saying that, in 1999, topped President Reagan a little bit by giving Max the highest civilian award in the United States, the Presidential Medal of Freedom. These are only two of the many honors that have been awarded to Max Kampelman in his life, every one of which have been richly deserved. And now, Freedom House is giving him another, our Lifetime Achievement Award. There isn't enough time tonight to list all of the good works that Max Kampelman has done. So I have to stop and simply say, thank you, Max, for all you have done in service to your country, to your fellow man, and to the cause of freedom in the world. All of that is shown a little bit more in the following video.
What I love about Max Kampelman is his passion for human rights and democracy. And I also love the fact that he loved debate. There were many ways of trying to achieve and advance human rights and democracy. He was always open to discussion, always open to looking to new paths, and I liked his inclusiveness. And I think that was certainly one of the winning elements in negotiation. He was someone who really ensured that there was an inclusiveness of process. And what was infectious and is infectious about Max is that his passion for human rights and democracy jumped off on others. He made them part of a process, and we benefited immensely from it.
Max is extraordinary for his courage and persistence, his willing to fight for the underdog. It's easy to forget that at the time he took over the Helsinki process and went to Madrid, that was at a time when Jimmy Carter was the first president, and Max was really the first senior government official to make human rights a central part of our foreign policy.
Permit me to say a few words about my belief in the power of the ought.
Max believes in the power of the ought, and Max preaches to all of us we ought to have a world free of nuclear weapons. And thanks in large part to Max, we're beginning to make headway.
Max has extraordinary courage combined with vision for the belief that anything can be done.
Max, you're a wonderful inspiration to all of us, and I congratulate you on getting this fantastic award.
Ladies and gentlemen, Max Kampelman, the winner, the awardee of the 2011 Lifetime Achievement Award from Freedom House. Max, here is your award, which I'll put back down here, but you take it with you.
That has to be interpreted.
It is the Freedom House flame, flame of freedom.
Thank you very much. I will confess to you that I had no idea that the film was being made or that there was going to be a gift tonight. And I therefore am very pleased, very proud, very thankful. I have a few comments to make. I suppose it's important and relevant. But before I do that, I just wondered if Leonard Sussman is here. He told me he would be here. Leonard Sussman. Leonard Sussman was the chairman of Freedom House during my first year of exposure to Freedom House, which was sometime in the 1940s, as I recall correctly. And Leonard indicated to me that he was going to be here during this function, and I'm pleased, though I don't see him with the lights. If he is here, I look forward to greeting him, because in my opinion, I knew of no American other than him who did more to advance the concept of dignity in international relations and humanity in international relations and democracy in international relations than Leonard Bernstein. And when he told me that he would be here, I decided I certainly would be here too. We are living in a complicated world, in a difficult world, in a very serious world as well. One of my activities is to be working closely with George Shultz, who appeared on this film, with George Shultz and a group that he organized in favor of the elimination, total elimination, of all nuclear weapons. I realize that at first blush, when that suggestion is made, particularly to experts, at first blush, as far as the public is concerned, they're with us on zero. But when I talk to the weapons experts, it becomes a little bit more difficult. I do believe, and have constantly believed, I noticed word indicated that I worked with Hubert Humphrey. I did work with Hubert Humphrey. I worked fairly closely with Hubert Humphrey for a number of years. And I also worked with Jimmy Carter and others. And what I have found during my experience, I have found that new ideas sometimes are simply difficult to pierce the wall. Active people have been saying things accurately which become a part of them. And when a new version or emphasis appears, it's difficult to overcome. And this issue, which I did not intend to speak about tonight, this issue of zero nuclear weapons is one which runs into that mental blockage, one might say, that I have found frequently in the debate taking place about tomorrow's world. For me, I see nothing better for tomorrow's world than to get rid of nuclear weapons. In any event, this is not the area in which to discuss or resolve that issue. What is important is the commitment that this organization, the members of this organization, the officers of this organization, and other organizations like it, understand the importance of commitment to human dignity. Because that, after all, is the element which distinguishes us from the rest of the animal world. And that, therefore, is, I suppose, what motivates me and has motivated me during these last few years. In any event, I do want to say that it's been an honor for me to have served as an officer of this great organization. And I want to make it very clear that in my travels in Europe and my assignment that was given to me unexpectedly and not looked for, which was to work with every single European country and examine the military problems that were shared, the civil problems that were shared, the civic problems that were shared. And that involved commitments on the part of countries who differed from one another. In many cases, there was religious hostility or religious competition, and it was economic competition. But I was asked to head up the United States and to see what could be done about harnessing together that responsibility, which as the largest country was our responsibility within the world. And Freedom House took a major role in preparing me for that assignment and also in permitting me to in effect, I think, be successful in that responsibility. There were 35 countries involved. And after 3 years of debate, discussion, meetings, arguments, we were able to develop a common commitment. And one of the reasons that I asked a little bit ago about the presence of the chairman of Freedom House in the United States at that time, the leader of Freedom House at that time. But what I found going through the democracies in Europe, I found that there was a yearning for peace, a yearning for freedom. And the absence of it, very demoralizing, but the benefit for it, producing great strength, great commitment, great understanding. And again, that was this organization, its parent, its international areas where it was respected. And I found that using the literature, using the commitment, during those difficult years of debate. So that I say to you, I say to myself, as we face here at this hour, that we are entering a new phase in the world. And it's our responsibility not just to talk about yesterday, but based on precedents and our early accomplishments, I suggest to Freedom House that we begin to emphasize again the issue of human freedom and human dignity in so many areas of the world that are still deprived of it. We here in the United States have an opportunity and an obligation to extend the principles that guided us and benefited us to other societies where they are human beings, mothers and fathers and children, yearning for dignity. And so I say, not just thank you, Freedom House, for what you've done, but thank you, Freedom House, for what I hope and believe you will continue to do. Thank you.
Our final presenter tonight is the Chair Emeritus of Freedom House. Betty Bow Lord is a distinguished author and activist for human rights and democracy. When President Clinton presented her with the Eleanor Roosevelt Humanitarian Award, he characterized her as someone who writes so powerfully about the past and is working so effectively to shape the future. It is my distinct pleasure to introduce Betty Bow Lord to present the final award this evening, the Freedom Award.
In the land of her ancestors, she is called the Lady. When she could only toddle, her father, aged 32, was assassinated. Barely a teenager, she left Burma to live, study, marry, work abroad, where she earned a doctorate and gave birth to two sons. Then in 1988, destiny called, though at the time she believed herself no different from any daughter answering a call from her ailing mother. At the same Rangoon hospital lay the bloodied, the dying, and the dead who had marched against the regime, along with hundreds of thousands students, monks, Muslims, mothers, fathers, shouldering tots. Conquering her innate shyness, she faced a rally of 500,000 at the Golden Pagoda and called for democracy. 8 months later, her party defeated the junta at the polls. Since then, off and on, from the age of 43 to 65, the lady has endured almost 20 summers and springs, 20 winters and falls in detention. Meanwhile, her boys matured without her hugs, her grandchildren enchanted without her kiss, her husband died without her hand. And yet, the lady, a delicate beauty of sheath and soul, is not crushed by sacrifice and loss, but stands as tall as Burma's highest peaks, inviting humanity to honor dignity and democracy. Aung San Suu Kyi.
You have to draw a line somewhere. You can't take everything. You can't allow any government to go on doing what they want to do. There has to come a time when you say, that's enough. This much and no further.
1988, forever burned in our hearts. Courage spread from Rangoon to Mandalay to Taungje. Our leaders rose from this 1988 uprising. Daw Aung San Suu Kyi is the daughter of our national hero, General Aung San, who freed us from colonial rule. The National League for Democracy Party, the NLD, is born with Daw Aung San Suu Kyi as its leader. But the generals want to keep control and put her under house arrest to keep her from running in the elections. Our lady locked away from us, but we keep her photo hidden between pages of books, quietly pass her words from home to home.
The lack of freedom does a lot of terrible things to people. It's only when you're deprived of your freedom that you realize how precious it is.
Tonight, I'm especially delighted to pay tribute to one of the truly remarkable women of our time, Aung San Suu Kyi. Under house arrest for 15 of the last 21 years, Daw Su's resolve, fearlessness, and sense of purpose have served as a testament to her unwavering commitment to the cause of freedom and to the people of Burma. She's inspired men and women who are struggling for democracy, basic rights, and just governments in their own countries. Daw Su is deserving of this Freedom Award and much more because of her unselfish devotion to the highest ideals of human dignity.
Via the global community in space, the lady accepts our Freedom House torch.
To receive the Freedom Award from Freedom House has a special meaning for me because of all the strong women who have been associated with Freedom House. Eleanor Roosevelt in the past, and now Madeleine Albright and Condoleezza Rice. Women whom I have always admired for their strength, their intelligence, and their dedication to public service. Freedom means choice, and freedom for many women all over the world means the right to choose what they want to do with their lives. This right is still denied to many women all over the world, not just to women, but also to men in countries where human rights have not yet become the basis of everyday life. When we say we fight for freedom, what we mean is that we would like the right to try to shape our lives into a pattern that we want for ourselves. This is simply what we most of us mean by freedom. And freedom rights, Freedom House, by expanding freedom all over the world, has done much to contribute towards this kind of freedom. So I would like to thank you very much for honoring me with the Freedom Award, and I hope that I will be able to make you proud of what we are able to achieve in the way of freedom in Burma. And I hope to make Burma a home for freedom, a big home where people can choose to lead the kind of lives that will help them to realize their potential and to fulfill the needs of the world around us.
Via this stage, An Ding, Executive Director and co-founder of the U.S. Campaign for Burma, will hold it in his hand.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us tonight to celebrate 70 years of advancing freedom. We once again thank our presenters and congratulate all our honorees, all inspiring men and women who've influenced the course of human rights and democracy. We hope you've enjoyed the evening. Good night.